on the bass and the congas. It always does. It's my fate in life. Singing drummer, always blocked by the mic. Every picture of me is like with a mic in my head. Everybody's phones are on silent?
Okay. Have fun.
Okay, waiting on you, right?
Yeah, have fun.
Okay.
Go for it. You're
thank you. Sunny. Yesterday my heart was filled with rain. Sunny, you smiled at me and really eased the pain. Dark days are gone, bright days are here. My sunny one shines, oh, sincere. Sunny one so true, I love you. Sunny, thank you for that sunshine bouquet. Sunny, thank you for the love you brought my way. My heart was sinking, sinking so tall. Now I feel like 10 feet tall. Sunny one so true, I love you. Thank you. Yeah, Sonny, thank you for the facts you let me see. Funny, thank you for the facts from A to Z. My life was formed like windblown sand. Then a rock was formed when we held hands. Sonny, one so true, I love you. Yeah, Sonny, thank you for that smile upon your face. Sonny, thank you for that gleam that flows with grace. You're my spark of nature's fire. You're my sweet, complete desire. Sonny, one so true, I love you. I love you.
Welcome, everybody, in the virtual world. We're very, very happy to have you with us this evening. I am super excited because I'm here with La Familia, my family. The name is not by accident. I started La Familia Sextet back in, I want to say, early 2004. This is our 17th year together. And everybody on this stage today was there for day one. So this is the original group, 17 years old. And I am super pleased and super blessed to have them here with me today. I'm going to introduce them now. I'm going to start with my right-hand man in the band. This gentleman hails from St. Petersburg, Russia. He's an amazing composer and arranger and band leader in his own right. He is a very, very dear friend who I've been making music with for over 25 years. Let's have a big hand in the virtual world for the great Misha Siganov. All the way from Graz, Austria. This gentleman is pre-pandemic, and I believe post-pandemic will be holding down all the low notes all over town. And you will also get a chance to appreciate his gifts as a arranger and composer later on in our set. Let's have a big hand for the wonderful Mr. Maximilian Schweiger. De Colón, Panamá, mi hermano en la timba, my brother in the drum. This gentleman has played with some of the most iconic names in Latin music, people like Gato Balbieri and Eddie Palmieri, Ruben Blades, Hilton Ruiz, Solicanto, the list goes on and on. He is my brother in the drum for many, many years, and I'm very blessed and honored to have him with us here tonight. Let's have a big hand for it. Renato Toms, en la tumbadora. From the great state of Oregon. She is another original member of the group. She is really, really special because she is not only, she is the epitome of a Latin jazz musician in that she has played with folks like the Duke Ellington Orchestra and Betty Carter And then she has also embraced clave in such a way throughout her life that she's just makes the transition so seamless. And she is our Rock of Gibraltar, my partner in time for many, many years. Let's have a big hand for the great Jennifer Vincent on the bass. And last but not least, Long Island City's own, when he's not winning Emmy Awards for his compositions on children's public television, he is haunting the finer dives in New York, playing the ukulele. But tonight, he's the asset. On the trombone, let's have a big hand for the great J. Walter Hawks. My name is Willie Martinez, and this is La Familia Sextet. I want to thank Lisa Charles and everybody here. You can't see them, but they're here, and they're showing us so much love. All of the folks here at Culture Lab, LIC, for bringing us here today to share our music with you. We really appreciate the opportunity. As you know, you're viewing on YouTube. This is a free concert, obviously. But if you are inclined to show a little love and visit our Venmo, the details are in the description on the YouTube link that you're at now. I will say no more about that until later. But a little bit about what we've played already. We have performed at the very first original composition of mine called After Winter, Spring. And then after that, we followed that up with the great Bobby Hebb classic, Sunny. Now we're going to visit something written by one of the pillars of Latin jazz, the great trumpeter, John Berks Gillespie, better known as Dizzy. And this is something called Con Alma. We're going to have a little petite conversation, Mr. Toms and I. Thank you. Yeah, that was Dizzy Gillespie's Con Alma. Hope you're having a good time out there. We certainly are. We're really enjoying ourselves. It's really wonderful to be back at this venue. We were here this past November, actually, playing in the yard. And now we're indoors, although albeit alone, but we're feeling you. And, well, we're not alone. I'm like super happy to see these people, this family of mine. I haven't seen them in a while, and it's really a joy to perform with them this evening. We're going to follow Con Alma up with an original composition of mine that's very dear to my heart. Both sets of my grandparents came from the island of Puerto Rico in the mid-20s and settled in Brooklyn, New York, where I was born. My parents were born there, I was born there, and my children were born there. So got a very deep connection with Brooklyn. And this tune is something that I dedicated to my grandfather, Maximino Martinez, who was actually from the town of Caguas, but grew up in a town called Calle. And I know that he spent his formative years in Calle, and something about that place really resonated with me when I thought about this tune and connecting it to him. And so it's called Calle, and it's dedicated to him and to all my grandparents for their journey
from the island to the mainland. But I further the dedication to all immigrants because immigration is such a deep issue, and so many people are struggling with it and trying to make their way here the way my grandparents did, to find a place where they could raise their children and have them see a brighter future. So I dedicate this tune, Calle, to all immigrants and their journey, their heroic journey to bring their children to a better place. Calle. Okay, we're gonna make a little sound adjustment. Okay.
We know she's first, right?
Yeah.
Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Thank you.
And when I introduced the band, I mentioned that we have several musicians that are very fine composers, but we're going to feature one right now. This is a really special tune. It's been with us for a long time. It's a tune that was written by our baritone saxophonist who is moving to curved soprano. He wrote it and dedicated it to his daughter, Eva Maria, when actually she was still in the womb. So we've been performing this tune. She's a precocious 9. Is she still 9 or is she 10? She's turning 10 in June. So we've been playing this tune for quite a while. And this is something that he wrote and dedicated to her. It's called Eva Maria qué linda eres.
Thank you.
Qué linda eres. Eva María, qué linda eres. Eva María, qué linda eres. Eva María, qué linda
Eva María, qué linda eres, written and arranged by Maximilian Schweiger. Hello, Eva María. Give a little shout out to Eva María and her beautiful mom, María Claudia. And while I'm at it, I'm going to give a shout out to my kids, my Jalen and Max. I hope they're tuning in. Probably not, but knowing them, they're gonna kill me. And I want to give a little shout out to a lot of people don't know that I'm also a drum whisperer. I build and repair drums, and I work at a place in the city called Steve Maxwell's. And I want to give a shout out to my boys over there, Jess Birch, and Eddie Torres, and Heather, and everybody there at the drum shop. We're gonna continue with a few more. Hope you're up for it. I know we are. We're gonna feature Walter actually on a common hardware item from Ace Hardware.
This one came from heaven. This was made of gold.
And this is a tune, very popular Cuban composer Luis Marchetti wrote this tune. It's a love song of sorts, in that he's in love with her, but her heart belongs to another. And this is his lament. It's called Plazos Traicioneros. We hope you enjoy. Cada vez que te digo lo que siento, tú siempre me respondes de este modo. Deja ver, si mañana puede ser lo que tú quieres. Pero así van pasando las semanas, pasando sin saber lo que yo quiero. Yo no sé para qué son esos plazos traicioneros. Traicioneros porque me condena y me llena de desesperación. Yo no sé si me dices que mañana, porque al otro le entregaste el corazón. Cada vez que te digo lo que siento, no sabes cómo yo me desespero. Si tu Dios es mi Dios, ¿para qué son esos plazos traicioneros? Blow your horn. J. Walter Hawks on the trombone. Traicioneros porque me condenan y me llenan de desesperación. Yo no sé si me dices que mañana, porque al otro le entregaste el corazón. Cada vez que te digo lo que siento, no sabes cómo yo me desespero.
Si tu Dios es mi Dios, ¿para qué son esos brazos traicioneros? Yo no sé, para qué son esos brazos plazos traicioneros.
Yeah, Walter. J. Walter Hawks on the trombone. Maximilian Schweiger on the baritone sax and the curved soprano. Misha Siganov on the piano. Jennifer Vincent on the bass. Renato Tomze en la tumbadora. My name is Willie Martinez. This is La Familia Sextet. Well, I promised I wasn't going to do that so much tonight, but I guess I will. Another important member of our group, the Love Bucket. So if you feel so inclined to make a donation tonight, all of it goes to La Familia. We really appreciate your generosity. So you can see the details for that in the description on the link that you're looking at right now. We're going to start wrapping things up. But before we do that, we're going to have a little bit more fun with something that I wrote for a very dear friend of mine, a great Latin jazz musician who worked with the great Tito Puente and with the great Mongo Santa Maria. We've known each other since we were teenagers. We went to the East Harlem Music School together. I'm talking about the great Latin jazz trumpeter, Mr. Ray Vega, who is up in Vermont teaching at the University of Vermont. This is a shout out to him. It's called something I wrote and dedicated to him. It's called Say Hey, Ray, and it's going to feature our bassist, the fantabulous Ms. Jennifer Vincent.
Thank you.
Woo! We hope you had a good time. We're going to say goodnight. Before I do, I want to introduce these wonderful family members to you one more time. The great Misha Siganov on the keys. Maximilian Schweiger on the baritone saxophone. Jennifer Vincent on the bass. Renato Toms en la tumbadora. In Long Island City Zone, J. Walter Hawks on the trombone. My name is Willie Martinez. This is La Familia Sextet. Many thanks again to Lisa Charles and all the folks here at Culture Lab LIC. Thank you for your love and for all of your hard work tonight. We really appreciate you having us here to share our music with all of you out there. Once again, if a little joy was brought to you tonight, maybe you can show a little love. We appreciate any contributions you can make. We're going to take off, and we'll see ya when we'll see ya. Buenas noches.
You guys want to do a little interview?
Sure.
All right.
Just get wherever you're comfortable. You guys might have to share a microphone. You're going to hook them up with that, right?
Sitting here. I need you guys to be.
Okay, very good. Step four, save before step on a light
track
bulb.
Of that. So that's going to be locked down.
Shall I walk over?
I'm sorry? No, right where you are. Right where you are. On stage.
We're ready to go. Guys, it's not just me.
Yeah, we want to hear from everyone.
Everybody.
Just go ahead and take the stage where the lights are, right where you were.
Be careful with the light bulbs. Are we passing this mic around? Is that right? Okay.
Yeah, that's fine. Hi, guys. Thanks a lot. That was really great.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to do.
All right, camera two, you're going to have to come much further to your right.
I believe it is.
There you go. So we'll give lock down two and a medium. Three, you're following the action. All right, thanks, guys. That was really wonderful. Thank you so much. So do you want to tell us a little bit? You guys have been playing together for how long?
17 years. We started in 2004. We recorded our first CD in 2005 and a second CD in 2010. We've been a little bit dormant for a while, but we've been together playing at the Nuyorican Poets Cafe every month. Held down that gig for 17 years as well, monthly, a monthly residence there that we are very proud of.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
So can you talk a little bit about your musical influences? Why this style of music? Where did it come from for you? What inspired you to do it?
Basically, I'm a second-generation Nuyorican. My dad and my mom grew up in New York City. They were born in Brooklyn in the 30s, so they experienced some really, really momentous occasions in music, bebop, Latin music at the Palladium, which was a great dance room back in the day, that was located actually right near Birdland around 52nd Street and Broadway. So I grew up in a family where music was a big part of our, you know, of our nourishment, along with the food and all the other customs. I've knew I wanted to be a percussionist since I was 10 years old, so it was a no-brainer for me, and I used to just love listening to records with my brothers in the basement and stuff like that. So as I got older, I kind of played in the trenches like most musicians do, you know, playing with a lot of different groups. But when it got to a point where I decided I wanted to start my own group, and some of my biggest influences probably were the great Cal Jader, Mongo Santa Maria, Willie Bobo, really also, though, Fort Apache, Jerry Gonzalez and Andy Gonzalez. That was a very, very important ensemble that was taking Latin jazz to the outer limits back in the 80s. And that was a really important influence on me. So when I started my group, I knew I wanted the trombone. I loved Barry Rogers, and I loved Eddie Palmieri, and I loved the sound of that instrument. But pairing it with something was kind of a question mark for a long time for me, until I kind of said to myself, you know, the classic jazz front line is trumpet and tenor. So when I thought of myself really wanting a trombonist, I said, well, maybe that would pair well with baritone, and that's the direction I went. And I am so happy I did, because it's really unique sound, and it's something different, and it's just, you know, it's got the bottom, but a lot of people don't realize the upper register of both horns. It's they have a really wide range, so it's a lot of fun to hear them express my musical thoughts and dreams.
Can we hear from some of the other band members as far as...
Why don't you guys talk a little bit about what it was like in the early days to be in this section together, you know, with it being trombone and baritone.
I hated all these people. No, Willie and I met. We were playing a concert of the Duke Ellington Sacred Concert, if I remember correctly. And we hit it off very well. And I had been playing in Wayne Gorbea's Salsa Picante, but hadn't really had a whole lot of experience in clave. And outside of that, I am just very happy that Willie pulled me into the fold here, as I have grown an incredible amount. And of course, I can't believe it's all the same people for so long, which, you know, you think about New York City and just the incredible amount of people and just how crazy all the musicians are. I mean, don't get me wrong, it's very rare we get the A-team like this. Thank the pandemic.
Right. We're lucky we're getting the A-team here. This is
so, you know, what do you think, Misha?
About you?
The Martinez restaurant story.
Oh, that's funny, yeah. So we started playing with Willie a long time ago, like 25 years ago, right? With Norman Hedman Trapeque. And this is a very funny story that I didn't know much about clave back then. And Norman Hedman, he told me that I should go to Willie's place and just take a lesson. And Willie got prepared. He prepared some playbacks for me. Remember, you recorded like some percussion so I could practice with. And you gave me a bunch of CDs. But the funny is, when I got off the train, I got on that corner. So I was looking for his place. And I saw right on the corner, big store. And it says Martinez store. And I just came to New York. I wasn't sure like what kind of band.
Where'd
is this,
you come,
what kind of,
where'd what, you
what,
come from?
Yeah, yeah. What type of salaries musician make here? I was new. And I thought, oh, I think I got a good gig, because drummer, he got a big Martinez store, you know. So I thought, you know, this band is making good money. So I thought, that's a good gig, you know.
Sure. I was a total greenhorn when I came to New York, and first in 92.
Where'd you come? You came to New York from where?
Actually, I grew up in Germany, but I lived in Austria at the time. I'm Austrian, and you know, because when you want to study jazz, you go to Austria first, of course. But so anyway, I went there, had a school there, and it's the oldest one in at the time. You know, I'm the last baby boomer. In Austria, they actually had a jazz program, so I went there, and coincidentally, that's where my family was from. So anyway, I spent some years there, and I thought I knew everything, and I come to New York, of course, and then I got my feet wet, not to say the whole body, and I almost drowned. But anyway, so I befriended another great saxophone player here, Pablo Calogero, who was a baritone, one of the major baritone players on the scene, I would say. And he was holding down a gig with the great Mario Bausa, and I had absolutely no idea who Mario Bausa was, who Machito and the Afro-Cubans were, who Tito Puente actually was, Eddie Palmieri, all the guys. And he played with all that. And he says, Max, you play baritone? I'm like, sure. So he sent me to sub for him in the great Mario Bausa band. And there were all the legends, Rudy Calzado, Patato, Victor Paz, and everybody, and you know, that was my introduced. Yeah, Joe Santiago and the great Bobby Sanabria at the time was still young, actually. Papo Pepin, not to forget. Yes, everybody, you know. And I had no clue. It was like, oh, Latin music, which is already the wrong term, right? Like, then the guys after the rehearsal, they would hang out on 106th Street in front of this little deli. Rudy Calzado and Victor Paz and Patato, and they would do all kinds of things. They would drink these little beers. And I would just sit there, and then they would like talk about the old times, whatever they were, like with the great bands. They talk about everything. And I had no clue what they're talking about. And Victor's like, don't worry, Max. You just need one record. Listen to it. Listen to it. That's how he would say it. The great Victor Paz, trombone player. And I did listen to it. And that's how I got introduced. And I was hanging out, and I loved it. I didn't know that you can dance to music like that, you know, at the time. And I.
Which record was it?
Machito and the Afro-Cubans. The Afro-Cuban Jazz Suite, and, you know, all the great Manteca Suite and those numbers. I can go on and on. Okay, Renato.
Anyways, well, I'm kind of the opposite because I came looking for jazz. I'm actually from Latin America. I'm from Panama. I grew up in Costa Rica. I think a lot of people in Costa Rica are watching. I sent a lot of messages to a lot of friends of mine. Although all my high school peeps, they might be watching. Colegio Metodista. I was always interested in jazz. I grew up listening to Latin music. I went to the classical conservatory back home, but I definitely had this curiosity for jazz. So I came to the United States to go to school in Boston, where at the same time that Misha was there, we were both together in Boston. And then after that, the trip is to New York, and I just been really blessed from day one, being playing with the people you're supposed to be playing here in New York, the reasons why I came here for, and growing all the time, and really, really, really blessed that as a sideman, in many occasions in the late 90s, early 2000s, I got to play with Mr. Martinez. And then when he, quite honored that when he decided to start his band, he chose me. He's percussionist, and here we are, 17 years after. You know, we all played. I've done a million gigs with Jennifer, because Jennifer does a lot of Latin gigs when we were playing 10 times a week. Jennifer was playing 15 times a week. Because yeah, but, you know, they always need a bass player. You know, you can do a gig without a percussionist or without a saxophone, but you always need a bass player. So when I was doing 10 gigs a week, Jennifer was doing at least 15 or 18. So, and thank you for the Culture Lab and all the people that are watching.
Thank you. Jennifer.
Cool. Yeah, so I just want to reference back to what a couple people said in this band, and that is that I almost bought Victor Paz's light blue station wagon. Yeah, I almost bought that. Yeah, yeah. And then what else? Let's see. Oh yeah, I met Willie didn't I meet you in Pasión? Yeah, there was this all-female charanga band. It was actually kind of cool repertoire-wise, and Willie was the one man in it, and we called it the one-man band. And he played timbales in it, and he was just awesome. And like when he asked me to be in his group, I think we were playing at Willie's Steakhouse, and then you broke it to me. Yeah. I'm like, are you serious? Me? Really? You know, seriously, thanks.
You know.
Oh, thanks. Well, but then, like, I want to reference back to what Walter said about we have all been in this band from the beginning, and that goes to show what a loyal person Willie is. And honestly, like, Willie's one of these people that, you know, sometimes we don't see each other for weeks or months at a time, but I consider you like one of my closest friends, and I think everybody in this band does, and that it goes to show what kind of character you have to keep a band together for such a long time. And then also, I have to reference something that Renato said, and that is that, what was it? It was a couple things. It's really great to play with you because you did come here for jazz, and you come from a Latin background, and you came for jazz, and you just kind of like seamlessly fit into either one. You know, like your feel goes between the both, you know, and you understand both so well, so thanks. Yeah, and so yeah, and that's it. Okay.
All right, so COVID's been kicking everyone's ass here, right? So, and the COVID winter, right? What did it mean to you guys? Does it inspire more work? Was it hard to get work done, obviously, because we couldn't meet? And what does the spring look like?
Yeah, it was super frustrating, I mean, to say the least. The New York pause in started on March 20th of 2020. And at that time, you know, we were all scared to death, people that I was talking to at least, and musicians were trying to figure out some way to jam together virtually. So there were a lot of software programs and stuff that we were all trying to get with, and it was getting super frustrating because I felt like I was like a millisecond away from happiness every time because of the latency.
It's the title of your memoir. Yeah.
And then I got invited to a jam session by some dear friends, Nikki and Anton Denner, she's a great piano player, an honorary member of La Familia, and Anton Denner, her husband, is a great alto player. They have a home in New Jersey, and they had a lot of space in their yard. So in May of 2020, they invited me over, and we had a jam session with a bass player, Melissa Slocum. And I just said, this is what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be about us being together. And so I started a series in front of my home on President Street in Brooklyn every Sunday from that point in May forward through November, every Sunday for 25 weeks, and called it the Sunday Afternoon Jazz Impromptu, and I had featured La Familia, but every week it was a different ensemble. So that was the way I kept my sanity. I would invite some of my best friends. I just happen to know a ton of musicians who were all super talented and just form ensembles every week, every Sunday, and just, you know, even though it was one day a week, it you could ride on that cloud, that energy for 1 week. And it was as therapeutic for the audience as it was for the musicians. I couldn't believe how much they missed being a part of this energy,
right?
Live music. And the musicians, it was just fantastic. We're going to reboot in April again, if you want to learn more about it, you can go to williemartinez.com. That was a really important move for me to take that step to try and get back to some kind of normalcy because the software was not doing it for me.
No.
The virtual thing was not working. It was like Zoom, like trying to do a jam session on Zoom. Yeah, the
latency messes it all up.
Oh, you know? Man, it's torture.
Even without latency, it's just you don't feel that energy.
Yeah, the being together.
First, it seemed exciting. Everybody was like, okay, we're going to learn new skills, you know. Well, you know, one door closes, another one opens. And yeah, at this time, you know, last year, everybody was searching for answers. I personally immediately switched. I said, okay, we're going to get a 2-month sabbatical or something, opportunity to do all these things that I haven't been able to do because of time or whatever. But then it really got frustrating. And about Willie Serious, I mean, it was 25 weeks. And I was part of the series as well. Willie kindly invited me, you know, 90% of the time I was there present. And the amount of people that would come, as Willie said, I was not so aware that people would miss us so much. People, and they sincerely missed us. I could see people would come, they would be looking forward to it. And there was a lot of generosity at all different levels, including financial, for these particular series. And it was quite amazing. And we keep it moving forward, you know, and keep learning. It's been quite a period of growth and learning, very humbling period, you know, and yep, a lot of introspection, but and a lot of growth above all.
Yeah. I think the public is really going to need as many live performances as possible when we come out of this, and we want to be able to help with that.
Yeah, well, you certainly are.
Thank you. So, you guys were talking when you guys first came in. We have a lot of countries represented here. Where are y'all from? Just give a quick shout out for all the different countries that are represented here.
From Russia, St. Petersburg. Does it work?
Yes.
Okay. Russia, from Russia with love.
Yeah.
I'm from the foreign country of Mississippi. Pascagoula, Mississippi. It's right near Escatawa, the Chicoutimi River.
Born and raised in Brooklyn, New York.
Nah, I love it.
Born in Austria and raised in Germany.
Born in Panama, and I said, you know, I spent many years in Costa Rica, mostly raised in Costa Rica, and I have a feeling that a lot of people in Costa Rica are watching because I did send the link, especially my high school friends from Colegio Metodista, so that's very exciting.
Mm-hmm. I'm from Oregon, but I also lived in Montreal for a year.
Nice. All right. I just want to thank you guys again. We want to give a big shout out to Glenn Forrest and Forrest Sound and Vision and GB's Juke Joint
for giving
us all the sound equipment comes from Glenn. So big shout out to him. Big thank you to Plaxol for donating the space so that we can do these things. And don't forget, please tip the band. We have all the information to their music, links to the music, and links to the Venmo. In the description of the video. And once more, thank you guys. Big round of applause for the 4 audience members that we are allowed to have in here because of COVID, but also all the people that are at home. Thank you everyone for watching, and thank you guys for playing. Good job, everybody.
Thank you, Henry. Thank you
very much. Good night. I need music. I need playing basketball, too.
Continue success. Thank you.